Buongiorno. First of all, let me express my gratitude to the organizing committee, Domenico, Bob, Jenna, Monica. Thank you all for supporting an exciting academic and human interplay under McLuhan's vibrant legacy. And I'm really proud to be part of this interplay. I'm glad to shape that communication with all of you. My paper is an humble attempt to address the topic of magic in Marshall McLuhan's thought. I try to prove how prominent is the topic of magic to understand human and cultural ecology. You can agree with me if I say that magic is rooted in human culture. It is a postulate of modern anthropology that there is a complete continuity between magic and religion. On the other hand, magic is also conceived as a proto-science, that is, science as an evolution of magic. Anyway, if we overcome these two trends of thought in anthropology and sociology of religion, we can agree that magic, religion, and science simultaneously operating in human societies, they coexist at every stage of evolution of societies and cultures, although they play different roles and functions. All this to say that magic has always been related to both social practices, art, religion, play, and scientific and technological development. Moreover, I wish to underline that the magic is one of the earliest manifestations of symbolic activity in modern humans. Ethnology has taught us that symbolic activity is what made us Homo sapiens sapiens. And therefore, please accept the idea that into all of us is still living a curious and fascinating man or woman, the Homo magicus. And Marshall McLuhan was absolutely a magical mind. Indeed, as an encyclopedic thinker and a Renaissance scholar, he was naturally interested in magism, alchemy, occultism, mystery religions. And as Thomas Nash thesis, McLuhan includes this concern, as well as poets like Yeats, Eliot, Pound, Joyce, Mallarmé shaped a framework for McLuhan in which he probes his interest in esoteric belief, occult, alchemy, and so on. After all, this insight about magic provided McLuhan with a key access to deeply understand relations between man and technology, as well as to explore how technology affects human consciousness. Well, let me show you a picture published in McLuhan's book, Mechanical Bride. At page 85, to probe the crucial role of played by media in shaping human perception, McLuhan refers to a popular 50s ad, such a mechanical totem, the well-known Wurlitzer jukebox, that, according to McLuhan, recalls the mask of a modern witch doctor, a wizard. In other words, something magic, able to embody the enchanting power of a brand new technological tool of the time. In fact, McLuhan agrees to use the term magic to describe the ensemble of emotions and activities evoked by this machine. That is to say, a gospel of magic, a technological spell for only 5 cents. And looking at how these people having fun, let me say that this machine seems an early form of a social media, a participatory experience, such as social magic created by Wurlitzer Jukebox. Indeed, McLuhan seems to suggest exactly what I like to define a return to magic. In the electric age, we are back to magic. What does it mean? At the first level, it means that our expectations for technology are, in a way, magical. McLuhan acknowledges that the magic power of all extensions of human senses and body. All technology has the Midas touch, golden touch. According to McLuhan, the very media have to be recognized as magical transformers. And let me say, understanding Midas. So, the arising of the personal computer in the 80s has been conceived as something magic. Look at this, the magic inside the machine. And to prove that magic is deeply related to a religious matter, I can show you another picture. Indeed, we have to acknowledge that the rhetoric of magical powers is rooted in technological discourses. All main players in digital cultures, and McLuhan himself, have been defined as a guru, a visionary, a witch doctor, the new electric or computer age. McLuhan, the high priest of pop culture. After all, any technologist is considered in a way a magician. We are fascinated by any new technology. It seems to have something magic. Any new technological device seems to us so mysterious. We are able to use it, it works so well, but we cannot completely understand how or why it works. Think about it. When a technology seems to be a black box, it becomes magical. That is to say, the unknown has such a magical power. Does this sound familiar? A second and most important element that marks a return to magic is encapsulated in the best-known concept of acoustic space. Acoustic space is conceived by McLuhan as a magical one. We stay once more in the magical acoustic sphere of pre-literate man, in the magical world of the air. Well, who was that pre-literate oral tribal man? And why tribal man's world was so magical? Why did tribal man need magic? Let's try to address those questions. First of all, to understand magic, we should consider magic as an attitude of a tribal man. Magic was the tribal man philosophy. It was his attitude toward the world. Everybody was a magician. Then, because tribal man is part of an integral awareness, he needs magic to grasp, to experience his selfness. Because tribal man lives in a village and therefore he is one with his community, he needs magic to affirm his presenceness. Because tribal man is one with nature, he needs magic to affirm and to invest in nature with spiritual energy. And because tribal man has no past, no history, He needs magic to overcome his nowness. Pay attention that these sentences work the same if you replace magic with religion. Moreover, in the oral and acoustic world, in preliterate cultures, in oral cultures, as Walter J. Young argued, tribal men can experience the power of spoken words. This power of spoken words is again a magical one, since it works in the exact moment it happens. It can be experienced only in the present, by the present. In this regard, just think for a moment about spells or prayers. In a spell or in a prayer is more easily to recall, in a prayer we use mostly present tense verbs. And I guess it is not coincidence. Anyway, following Walter Young, spoken words are a form of action. They are events. They happen in the present moment. The main feature of the oral cultures is the occurrence, the happening, as well as the happening is the main feature of a magic ritual. Again, the enchantment, the magic power of words, the presence of words, as Walter Young argued. For these reasons, both magical rituals and religious rituals share a special relation with spoken words. Spoken words are nothing but manifestations of God, manifestation of a deity, a divinity. Spoken words themselves are magic, the God spell, whereas the prophet is the spoken man, in Greek prophetess, who speak before. Like a spell or a prayer, spoken words work in present, in the present. Tribal man has no past, no history, since spoken words are his present, since they express his human condition, nowness. In this regard, think about kids. A child before 2 years old have no awareness of past and future. For him, only present exists. I have 2 kids and I can confirm. Along with verbal development, children learn to conceptualize a before and after. But at times awareness comes later, about 6 years old. So, child is like a tribal man. And I guess in general, our times awareness, our perception of past, present and future is first of all not biological, indeed it is cultural. Well, following McLuhan, as well as according to media ecology tradition, we know that writing, and in particular the phonetic alphabet, was a game changer. As both Walter Young and Jack Goody, just to name a few, argued, at the beginning, writing was conceived as a secret and mysterious tool related to magic and occultism. Writing became a civilized substitute for magic. And my thesis is that any new technology at the beginning, any new medium in its early phase, becomes a civilized substitute for magic. That is, the change of scale or pace or pattern that any medium introduces into human affair concerns our relation with magic. In other words, any new medium extends the homo magicus who exists in all of us. And so, any new medium is an extension of man's attitude toward magic. Well, when literate men began to use writing instead of magic, a turn in human consciousness occurred. In fact, Ong explained the shift from magic to science as a consequence of a cultural shift from orality to literacy. Moreover, writing creates history, Literate man has past, has future. Spoken words lose their magical powers. For literate men, verba volant scripta manent. Words fly away, and those written remain. You know, writing technology transforms man. Therefore, the role of magic in a literate culture is different. Literate men, as well as the Gutenberg's man, transforms and reverses his relation with magic. Because literate man is alone with his selfness, with his individualism, and because he is detached, he needs magic to be part of an integral consciousness. He needs magic to be in touch with his community, to reconnect himself with nature. Because literate man has a specialist knowledge, he needs magic to grasp a holistic wisdom. Because literate man is so rooted in his past and his history, he needs magic to experience his nowness. Well, we know that electric technology once again has been a game changer. The 20th century man has been enhanced by new electric technology. Electric technology became again a substitute for magic. The 20th century man has been caged, captured in an electric web powered by radio and television, first of all. The electric web created by mass media shaped a new kind of man. The mass man, unaware of his state of narcosis and numbness. Following McLuhan, the mass man is fascinated by new extension of himself, mass technologies. The mass man tried to use mass media as a form of magic to be part of an integral awareness and of an integral consciousness, to be in touch with his community, to be part of the global village. But it was an illusion. The electric web powered by mass media was monodirectional, one way, one too many. The mass man was the real content of mass media. But he was not himself a magician. He was not a real player. Indeed, he was played by media. He was enchanted by the spell of mass media. The big brother became the new electric shaman, the guru, the magician. In other words, as Elena Lamberti yesterday argued, mass men not allowed to control the communicative process. The magic of communication was controlled by the shamans of mass age. And what about now? What about the contemporary media environment? What about the new human and cultural ecology shared by social media? What about the social man? First of all, let me underline that today, in Western our globalized societies, orality and literacy coexist, as well as a visual and acoustic space coexist. We are both tribal and literate men. Indeed, we are something else, something more. However, the Homo Magicus still exists inside us. In this regard, I like to define the post-secondary orality age as the age of mass recording devices. Indeed, early introduced in the 19th century by mechanical reproduction of photography and film and phonograph, and later by electronic video and audio tape, and then by digital recording. Personal recording is a new form of writing, a new form of literacy. And there's an interplay between orality and literacy. And social media catalyzed that interplay. Recording technologies have affected our relationship with words. Nowadays, the ancient Latin motto verba volant scripta manet seems to work in reverse. By Twitter, for example, scripta volant, writing flies away. Instead, by YouTube, for example, verba manent, spoken words remain. By mobile phones or smartphones, we are able to extend, to enhance the magic power of spoken words in order to replace the enchantment of an action, to grasp the moment in which something happens. Posts on Twitter seems to be new spell. Our Facebook status sounds like a prayer, present tense verbs. Hashtags are the new magic formula. Flickr and Instagram provide us a chance to tell stories in a visual way. Tweeting itself, tweeting and Twitter is a new oral storytelling or story tweeting. Again, the enchantment of words, the enchantment of images. Words and images are new spell and new idols. Smartphones are new talismans. Tablets are new magic mirrors. Also, by social media, we play. And play is nothing but an ancient form of magic. Magic derives from play. Even more, social media are a new way to manage our presence in the world. A way to extend our presence. They are an extension of a subjective experience, an extension of the self. Online posting, tweeting, the blogs, instant updating, the dissemination of pictures and videos by Facebook and Twitter or Instagram represent a new way of accessing, storing, and sharing experience. For example, this behavior can be observed during a concert, or a live show, or a public dramatic event that one witnesses in person. So, let's think about it. Most people tend to follow that event by keeping their eyes fixed on their mobile phone or camera and keep recording what they see but by their device rather than actually watching what is happening in front of them. I can show you an emblematic picture of this habit. It is the recent funeral of Lucio Dalla. Lucio Dalla was one of the most loved singers in Italy. His funeral has been celebrated in Bologna, where I live, with a large number of people. Look at. You can count more than 20 cameras. All this to say that recording in the age of social media is indeed an extension of presence. And also it is an attempt to capture the magic of a ritual, to grasp the nowness, to grasp the present, the happening. Mobile devices and social media give us the opportunity to experience a magical power. This new enchantment of technology provides us a chance to extend nowness, presenceness, selfness. I'm going to finish, but I want to show you another emblematic picture, an example of how mobile communication can extend a presence. Here we are at the Western world, so-called waiting world. That picture speaks for itself. Also, it is interesting to note how, in recent years, the bloodiest and catastrophic events of the international scenario, let's think about the ending of Saddam Hussein, or the capture of Colonel Gaddafi, or again the tsunami in Southeast Asia, the earthquake in Japan, as well as the very recent sinking of the Costa Concordia cruise ship in Italy. These events have generated their home power precisely in the form I've just described, as an image acquired life that becomes an extension of presence. I was there. An attempt to grasp the nowness in all its exclusive, emotional, and magical power, in spite of their low quality and low definition images. Finally, if we accept the idea that any new medium at the beginning becomes a substitute for magic, then we have to acknowledge that we are using social media in a magical way. We are enchanted by social media. We are fascinated by them. Indeed, Marshall McLuhan seems to alert that there is more to discover. And this ad turns in a warning. There is something more beyond the magic that changes moods. Thank you.